Hey, church. Hey. You guys are getting it. I like that. Hey, last week we started this series called Hey, Church, and I just want to tell you a little bit of my story of how I even found myself serving in the church. So I was 19 years old when I really felt like God was impressing on me and calling me to be able to give my life into ministry, and I went kicking and screaming. Some of you guys have been around here long enough to know you've heard my story with this, But that's not something I was going, that's really what I want to do. God, please, can I? You know, I'd really like to do that, you know. And that just wasn't. I loved God, and I certainly wanted to be part of a church, but I just didn't want to be working in the church. And so I was very resistant to that. When finally I was going, okay, God, I see that's really what you want me to do. Okay, I'll do that. I really wasn't even sure what that meant, what role I was going to have, what I was going to be doing, how I was going to be serving him inside of the church. I just did not know. I started my education and started pursuing practical theology with my education. And as I started pursuing that, that's when I started to discover that, okay, you know what I want to do? I want to do youth ministry. So I want to work with teenagers. And so I started that. And by the time I graduated from college and I began to start working in ministry, I realized this, that I wanted to serve inside of the local church for 5 to 7 years. And that was all I wanted to do. I just wanted to serve for 5 to 7 years inside the local church, be on staff at a local church. And then from there, I wanted to begin to be a traveling communicator. And I wanted to go around and travel mainly the United States, travel maybe a little bit outside of the States. But I wanted to travel, and I wanted to be a youth communicator that would just travel around doing camps, doing other weekend engagements, and doing conferences. And so that was what my heart's desire was, and what I started to think, that's what I'm going to do. But then I started getting involved in this church ministry, and I did a summer job, and then I ended up doing an internship a year and a half later after I graduated, and then I landed my first position being a youth pastor, and after having spent a couple of years with that same group of people, I went, I really like this. I like hanging out with these people. I like getting to know these people. I like doing life with these people. I like the relationships. I like the community. I like seeing the journey. I like seeing how they are moving through and progressing along in their faith journey. I liked it. I actually fell in love with the local church. Fell in love because of the people of the local church. And I decided, you know what? That's just what I want to do. I want to stay inside the local church. And that's kind of how it happened for me and why it is that I'm still doing the ministry that I'm doing, is because I love the idea of being connected to a group of people that I get to see over the long haul of what gets to take place. And so I fell in love with that. Well, as we started this series last week, Hey Church, this isn't one of those series, because it's really interesting, if you just kind of see the heading and you can go, okay, well, what does that mean? Because it's real easy, especially if you're like with us and maybe you're here for the very first time and you're like going, what kind of church is this that all these people are gathered in just to be chastised? Because you just saw this title, Hey Church, you're like going, it's like means, hey, church! You know, and you're like going, I don't know if I really want to be here if that's the kind of church that I've just come into. But it's not. That's not the sense that we're going with this series. In fact, we're going to be in this book of Ephesians all the way through for a total of 6 weeks or 6 chapters. We're going to be in it all 6 weeks. So we're going to be in chapter 2 today. And so some of you overachievers have already gotten there. And some of you just got reminded, oh, yeah, I'm an overachiever. I've got to get there. You know, and so now you're starting to pull it out. But I'm encouraging you guys to follow along in your Bible as we go through all this and make some notes in your Bible. But as we look at this and we look at this idea of, hey, church, it's about getting to the heart of what was happening. Because the person that wrote this book, or if you will, it was actually a letter when it was first written, and he wrote it, and his name's Paul, and he wrote it with more of the sincerity of a hey, church. And it was this, hey, let me make sure that I'm touching base with you. Let me make sure that I'm encouraging you. Let me make sure that I'm equipping you. Let me remind you of some things that you just need to be reminded of. Let me give you some instructions on some things of what you need to be doing now that you have this knowledge and now that you have faith, now that you have Christ living inside of you. And so it's really this sense of, hey, church. And that's where we're going with this entire series. So last week as we launched this, we looked at this idea right here. We looked at the idea of know your identity. It was this, hey, church, know your identity, as in knows whose you are, know to whom you belong.
And the reason that was something that we just looked at from the start is because as Paul's writing, he's writing to people that are already convinced of who Christ is. He's writing to people that they are believers. They are belongers. They belong to God because they believe in Jesus. And as he's writing to them, there's somebody that they're going, okay, so we believe, we belong, and so we need to hear some of this stuff. And as he's writing to them from the very get-go, he says, hey, grace and peace to you. He wants to make sure that they understand, hey, the one thing I keep praying for over and over and over again is that you would experience God's grace and that you would experience his peace. And so as we looked at this thing called grace, this is the thing that we said, hey, it's important to note about grace. That grace is something that's not automatically received. But what is this thing called grace? Well, grace is this undeserved favor, this undeserved kindness. That's grace. And it's not this thing, it's not automatically received. In fact, grace is even something that we can resist. We can go, no, thanks, not right now. Maybe, you know, we can resist it. We can even reject it. And, you know, to my experience, the people that end up rejecting grace, people that reject God's grace are often people that they've rejected even the grace of others. And then there's something about pride that gets in the way when it comes to receiving grace. Because there's some people that whatever the hardships, whatever you've experienced in life, whatever difficulties you've faced, you've become convinced that the only thing good that's ever happened in your life is because you've worked hard to make that happen. That it's only because of what you have done. And there's some people that this pride just kind of gets in the way. And they're like going, no, I'm not sure I need that grace because I think I can get where I need to get on my own. And everything that good has ever happened to me, it's happened to me because of what I have done. And so they can resist the grace, the kindness from others. They can even resist God's grace. But we can get to the point where we even say, you know what, I'm not just resisting it. I'm rejecting it. I don't want to hear about it anymore. I don't want to know about it anymore. I don't want to be offered it anymore. Leave me alone with the grace. And this can happen with people. See, God's grace, though, is something that we all need. And Paul's just reminding the church, hey, grace and peace to you. But he's wanting them to know that to who do you belong? Know your identity. So we looked at this passage last week in chapter 1, verse 5. And he said, God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. As we looked at this whole idea of God and this grace thing, what we did is we looked at this and we said, hey, grace is always at God's initiative. That God's the initiator, and God initiates offering us grace. And in order for us to receive his salvation and forgiveness, it's because he initiated it, not because we all of a sudden went, ooh, I need to get that. I better go find that. I better go hunt that down. I think that's what I need. It's always that God initiates it in us, and we respond to his initiative. That God loves us, and he chose us. And as we looked at this and what Paul was communicating and writing to these believers, we looked at this and said, hey, let's just take a moment and try to understand this thing that gets thrown around sometimes, and it's this predestination. And so we are predestined, that God predestines us. And as we're predestined, that God created us with an ideal path, that an ideal purpose, what it is that he would want us to do, want us to have, want us to experience, he laid out, this is going to be the best plan for you. This is how you're going to get the most out of life. And he predestines us for this. But he doesn't predetermine that we're going to have to live that out. He doesn't say, I'm going to strip away choice. You're not going to have a choice. You're going to do exactly what I created you for. He still creates us with a purpose, and he has this ideal destiny in mind and this path that we would be taking to get there. But because we have free will, we get to choose what we're going to do with our life. We don't always follow that path. And so there's a difference between this idea of that we're predestined or that he literally has predetermined all of our steps, and we don't even get a choice, and we have to do what he has determined. Here's a way to understand that even further. That if God was somebody, that he pre-selected everybody who was going to go to heaven, and nobody had a choice in it, and he pre-selected everybody, then that would also mean that God would what? Pre-select everybody who was going to hell. And so if God ends up creating somebody, selecting from the very beginning that you don't have a choice and you're going to go to hell, that would mean that God is the creator of what is evil. And God doesn't create evil. There's nothing evil about him. And so, yes, he has a plan for us. Yes, he has a purpose for us. And the more we get on board with that plan, the more we're going to live the blessed life that we ever could, the life that he has for us. So it's always been his plan to adopt us, to bring us into his family, and it would give him great pleasure. And we looked at this last week from this idea of what adoption does and what it changes for us, that it changes our heritage. It changes our identity. It changes our mentality. It changes our outlook on life because now it's like, I'm loved. I'm chosen. I am wanted. This is what adoption does for us. And once we believe, we belong. Well, today we're going to talk about amazing grace. This is amazing grace. Once God's grace is understood, once God's grace is actually experienced, it's really a kind of a letdown to refer to it as simply grace. This undeserved favor, this undeserved kindness. Because once we become in touch with how far away from God we were with our sin, and to see that he loved us so much to draw us near to him, and now we get to be in a relationship with him, that once we've experienced that, it's something that's more easily referred to as amazing grace. See, grace is the gift. That grace is the gift, and amazing is the description. And it is amazing that God would give his undeserved favor, his undeserved kindness, that he would reach out to humanity. And it is amazing that he would do that. And that I get to be loved by God. So Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. We're not going to get through all of chapter 2. We're just going to read parts of it today. And then we're going to be in chapter 3 next week. And we're just going to keep moving forward. But starting in verse 1, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. Now, at first you can look at that and go, wow, that's kind of harsh. That's kind of difficult. That's kind of like, that's really negative. And I don't need any more negativity in my life. It's not negative if you actually look and you understand this very first word. Once. As in formerly. See, it's past. Because who's he writing to? He's writing to the church. Hey, church. So he's writing to the church. And this word church is this word ekklesia. And this word ekklesia that we get from our Greek, that we look at this word, it can mean assembly, it can mean congregation. More times than not, it's a straight translated church. And then it can also mean the body of believers, everybody who is a believer. We kind of refer to that as capital C church. Everybody who's a believer is part of the church of God. And so we look at this, and so just a couple of times in our Bible when we look at this word, it's translated congregation. Three times we look at it, it's translated assembly. But over 100 times, it is translated church or churches. And he's writing to the church, the people who already believe. And so this verse 1, once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. So dead, once you were dead, once you were spiritually dead, as in you were separated from God. And when you're spiritually dead, the path that you are on is a path that's going to keep you forever separated from God into all of eternity, including being in a very real place called hell. That if you are dead, spiritually dead, then you don't have a place in heaven. It's only for those that God has adopted who have received the grace that he has offered. And so the spiritually dead, being separated from God, and we're separated because of our sin, because of our disobedience, because of not obeying what he wants for us. Even when we didn't even know what he does or doesn't, but I didn't know. He's laid it all out. And we have our Bible to look and see. And so whenever we look at church in our Bible, whenever we look at and we see this word, whenever we refer to it in the context biblically, it is always referring to people who are convinced of who Christ is. Christians, Christ followers, people who are believers, people who are belongers. That's who the church is. And he's writing to the church, verse 2. And as he writes to the church, you used to live in sin. Who used to live in sin? The people who are now forgiven of their sins. The people who are the believers. You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. And he is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. That he's at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. The devil, aka Satan, he is just as real as Jesus. And there are a lot of people who sit in churches and they think, oh, no, Satan's not. Yeah, Jesus is real, but no, not Satan. He is real and his power is at work. And God allows him to have some limited power now. But eventually his power is going to be all stripped away from him. Verse 4. I'm sorry. Verse 3. All of us used to live that way. What is that way? Sin. Just living out our lives however we want to live them. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger just like everyone else. So our sin nature, it's this natural way that we would want to be living out our lives selfishly. What's in it for me? What can I get? That's natural for us. In fact, we even have a passion that drives us to live our lives for ourselves. Trying to figure out, what can I do to enjoy life? What can I do to enjoy the moment? What can I do to experience the thrill? What's in it for me? This is what's driving. There's a passion within us that naturally wants to have that. We all have an attraction to various sins. In fact, Satan even will customize the temptations to each of us because we're not all tempted with the same sins. And he customizes the temptations for us on ones that he thinks that we'll bite on, that we'll snap on, and we'll go, oh, I think I'll take some of that. Sometimes we're even convinced, well, I can just nibble a little bit and not get hooked. But we often get hooked. See, he's tempting us. Verse 4. Do you see these very first two words of verse 4 I really like? But God. It's always interesting when you see those two words. But and whatever pronoun, whatever personal pronoun, whatever person's name, and whatever you see with that, it's always interesting. In fact, when I think of this but God, it kind of takes me back to some memories of my own home. And I think about sometimes that my kids have thrown out this word but in our home. And when they throw out this word but, more times than not, the name that follows but, it's probably like your house. And it's this: Mom. But Mom. And it doesn't come across like but Mom. It often comes across like but Mom. You know, it's one of these kind of things. And it's like, but Mom, and it's one of the things, and when that comes out, it's this thing, and it's what it's saying, I don't think that's fair. I don't think I should have to. I don't think you should keep me from. I think I deserve. And it's whatever that is, and it's this, but Mom. And then there's some times when I actually hear this when Mom's not even around. And so I'm trying to tell my kids what I think they need to do or what they're not going to be allowed to do. And I can hear, but Mom. And then I can hear a description of what Mom would allow them to do, what Mom would allow them to get away with. You know, when I think about our family, Cheryl's like the grace and I'm like the law. That's just kind of the dynamic in our household. She's the grace, I'm the law. And so I can hear this, but Mom, I don't hear it a lot, but there are times that I actually hear this. But Mom, and it's like this is their go-to defense on what it is that they should be allowed or shouldn't be required when I'm asking them to do so, or they shouldn't be prevented from. And but see, there's a third way that this comes out. And it's a way that comes out when mom's not present and the kids aren't the ones saying, "But mom." And instead it's me who's bringing up the phrase. And for me to bring up the phrase, "But mom," and it usually is in the context of, I'm reminding them of my position and what they're not going to be allowed to do or what they have to do. And then I say, "But mom, talk to me." And so I'm going to let you. And so see, whenever it's that position, that's when it's always the most favorable. That's when it's the most favorable. And here's Paul. And as Paul is writing to the church, to the believers, he's writing to them about something that's very favorable. And he says, "But God." Because he's been talking about how you once were dead in sin. You once just used to live that way with following your passionate desires. But God, and let's look at the rest. "But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much." So we talked a lot about grace last week, talked some about it today. And grace is this great thing when we get to receive, or at least offered it. We're offered something that we don't deserve. It's unmerited, and it's just this favor that we don't deserve. But mercy is a little different. Mercy and grace, they're different. And mercy is this. Mercy is when you don't receive what you do deserve. That's mercy. That you've done something bad. You deserve some punishment. You deserve some correction. But because of mercy, it doesn't happen, or it happens very lightly. And so Paul is saying, "But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much." Verse 5, that even though we were dead because of our sins, dead being separated from God, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. And it's only by God's grace that you have been saved. And this saved, this rescuing is what it is. And we're saved from and to. That we're saved from the penalties of our sin. We're saved from having to live out all of eternity in hell. That's what we're saved from. We're saved to a relationship, an unobstructed relationship with God, to where we're going to get to spend all of eternity in heaven with God. It was being a saved from and being a saved to. It's by grace that you've been saved. Verse 6, "For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms, because we are united with Christ Jesus." So God can point to us in future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness toward us, as he has shown in all he has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. And then we get to the two power verses of chapter 2, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. God saved you by his grace when you believed. God saved you by his grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things that we have done, so none of us can boast about it. That none of us get to be a bragger. None of us get to look at, hey, I'm somebody that I've been saved by God's grace. Oh, you're not, and you're still a heathen. You know, oh, nanny, nanny, baby. You know, we don't get to do that. Because it's by God's grace that we have been saved. Four keys for understanding salvation. So there's four keys that we can look at and that we get to see that we find right here in 8 and 9. See, what Paul was saying earlier is he was saying, hey, you used to live in sin. They used to live in it. And see, what's the difference between that person who lived in it and now somebody who's been saved by grace? And you're not living in sin, but you can still sin. It's not that once we experience God's grace, we never sin. But we just don't live in sin anymore. I like to think of it this way. This thing about living in sin, I kind of think of pigs when I think of trying to understand what it's like to live in sin. Because see, pigs, they just want to make a party of anything. That you put them in their pen, and there they are in their pen, and it's all a party place. I mean, they're just going to walk around and I go, you know, and they're just having fun, having a blast. They're just kind of trying to make a party, whatever. In fact, they'll go over and they'll look and they'll just kind of see their food. Now, I don't really want some of that right now, but I want a party. And so what do? They just kind of flat on their back and they just kind of, you know, and they just kind of roll around. And they're just making their own, they're just living in it. They're living in that pen. They're caged in, but they can't even tell they're caged. Because they're just living it and enjoying the moment. Then they get hungry and they're like, oh, let me go eat some of that. And so there's the slop, and so they start eating it, and they're messy, right? And so as they're eating it, this stuff's just going everywhere. And they kind of eat their fill, and they're like, well, I don't really need any more, but wow, that looks fun to play in. And so what do? They just start playing and rolling in it, and they just have fun in it. See, they're just living in it. But for you and I, we don't live in sin once we accept this offer that God gives us. We don't live in it. We don't go, hey, I'm just going to try to delight myself in any way that I can. Now, we might return to sin. We might do some sin. We might go and say, I'm going to go do that. We kind of know that's really wrong, but, you know, I can justify it. I'm going to do it. And then we find out later, you know, that kind of hurt us or hurt some other people. But it's not like we live in it. That's what grace is. It changes our outlook. Being adopted, it changes our outlook. And so we need to look and go, hey, what are these understandings? How do we understand this thing called salvation? And so as we look at this, these four keys, here they are. Key number one is amazing grace. So that's the first key to understanding salvation. That this is God's grace. It is amazing that God chooses to offer this undeserved kindness to us. Amazing grace. Second key that we understand through Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. Through faith. Through faith. That faith is what connects us to where we get to experience that grace. Faith is what allows us to go, hey, I want to receive this adoption offer. And so I'm putting my faith in this offer, God, that you sent me through your son, Jesus. So it's amazing grace. It is through faith, a gift from God. That this gift, it's given freely. There's no strings attached. It is here you go. And then this last one, not a reward. It's not a reward. It's not a reward for good behavior. Not a reward, okay, well, if you'll start turning your life around, okay, well, then I'll go ahead and give this to you. And this is one that we have a hard time with, that we end up struggling with. We struggle with this whole not a reward piece because we like to earn. We like to feel like I've done something and I deserve that, so I should have it now. In fact, that will interfere. If we have those thoughts, that's going to interfere with our connection with God at times. And the reason it's going to interfere with our connection with God at times is because there's going to be times when we haven't been earning it. In fact, we've been doing some things that we know God's really disappointed in us with. And because of that major disappointment that we feel like, oh, God's disappointed in me, I haven't earned it, I really can't pray to him right now. I want to, I need to. But I've got to wait until I start doing more good so I earned the opportunity to pray to God. And some people will take it as far as, well, I can't be forgiven yet because I haven't earned the ability to be forgiven. And so we wrestle with this. we wrestle with that. And I think where Satan comes in and wreaks havoc on this is I think we look at our sin. We look at our faults. We look at our failures. We look at our mistakes. We look at our screw-ups, whatever you want to call them. And we just put a period. Satan puts a period, and he's like, that's it, period. You blew it. You don't deserve, period. You shouldn't have, period. How dare you, period. He just comes along and just puts a period there and wants us to kind of just go, well, then I'm just kind of stuck. I'm left here. What is it that I can do then? Because I've messed up. I have blown it. Let's look a little further. Verse 10. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. He creates us anew so that we can do, not that we will do. It's not so you're going to be forced to. It's so that you can. He enables us and empowers us to be able to do the very things for which he created us for. That we're his masterpiece. And a person who's been saved from their sins by receiving this amazing grace, they're created anew. And so it doesn't stop with a period. That's what Satan wants us to think. But see, what Jesus comes along and does is he changes it for us. And what used to be a period changes. And when Jesus comes along and he changes things, he turns our life upside down. And he puts a comma. And he separates, that was before you allowed me to give you my grace. That was before you experienced my forgiveness and my restoration that I offer you. And the comma, it changes everything. The grace changes our sin-filled life to a life experiencing restoration. That's what grace does. That it changes our sin-filled life to a life experiencing restoration. What grace comes along and does is it says, there was a then, and now we have the now. And it changes our lives. Verse 13, our last verse. But now, you have been united with Christ Jesus. Once you were far away from God, but now you have been brought near to him through the blood of Christ. Once you were far away, but now you have been brought near. Why? Because of the blood of Christ. Jesus, who is the ultimate blood sacrifice to satisfy the payment that sin demands. Jesus became the ultimate sacrifice. And that if we will receive his gracious offer to be forgiven and to be restored and be being brought back to a right standing with God, how humanity was created from the very beginning when God created Adam and Eve and there was no need for restoration. They lived in harmony with God the way they were meant to be until they sinned. And Jesus comes and makes this sin payment so that we can be near to God, to where we get to separate what our life was before God from what our life looks like now that we have God. I think the one thing that I can give you that would drive all of this home would be this. I once was lost, comma, but now am found. This
is amazing grace. I once was lost, but I didn't stay that way because of God's amazing grace, because of His initiative of seeking me out, but now am found. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, Your grace is absolutely amazing. That God, who You are and what You do for us, that amazing even falls short of describing how wonderful You are to us. Thank You for looking at humanity in our sin and our faults and our failures, and looking at us and still seeing that there is a person that I choose to love and that I have a plan for and that I want to restore, that I want to bring into my family. Thank You, God, for thinking of us this way, for seeing the possibilities that You created us for seeing that there is a better hope for us if we would allow You to change our period into a comma. And for us to go from living a life that we were dead in sin, we were separated from You, to living a life where we are connected to You, that we see that we are found by You. This is amazing grace. Jesus, thank You for being that delivery agent for this amazing grace. Jesus, it's in Your name we pray. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Yeah.
for your amazing grace. Thank you for opening our eyes to see that grace and accept it from you. Thank you, Lord.